Hello. I've had at least three people come up to me this afternoon and tell me that they thought I was exaggerating about the Blue Angels. So have you enjoyed the show? Yeah. Another person said, was this cheaper than fireworks? Is this why we had them? Yeah. One of the things about the Blue Angels being here during SOCAP, the pieces that I think SOCAP is so much about is how we are living in the face of culture that tells us one thing when we know in our hearts that we want something else. And I love the Blue Angels, and I hate what they stand for. And having the Blue Angels here this week is just kind of a big reminder that our excitement doesn't always go where our hearts go, and to pay attention. So I just thought I would share that little piece of my heart with you about that. One other quick thing that I want to tell you about or to remind you about is the entrepreneurs who have been nominated for gratitude awards. The time to vote for them is now. And the URL where you can do that, I believe I have it right, is bit.ly gratitude15. Gratitude Awards 15. Thank you. I heard a small voice from our next person coming to the podium, Lindsay Smalling, who's going to come and talk to us about this afternoon's program. So thank you all for being here.
Thank you for reminding me. Say that again.
Hi, everyone. It's the afternoon, but some of my favorite plenary sessions are in this one, so thank you so much for being here after a long day. We're going to kick it off. We've had some amazing speakers today. We've got a visitor from the north. So I'm excited to welcome the Honorable Brad Duguid, the Ontario Minister of Economic Development, Employment, and Infrastructure. As minister, his focus is on creating jobs, promoting Ontario as a smart place to invest, building a culture of entrepreneurship, and growing a strong, innovative economy that's inclusive to people of all abilities. Prior to this post, he served in a number of cabinet roles, including Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities, Minister of Economic Development and Innovation, Minister of Energy and Infrastructure, Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, and Minister of Labor. He's pretty much done all of those. He also served municipally as a city councillor in Scarborough and Toronto for 9 years. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Honorable Brad Duguid.
Thank you, Lindsay. That introduction may be longer than my comments, but Lindsay, thank you so much. And Lindsay's left the stage here, but I've had an opportunity to meet her in the past. What a dynamo in this sector. Give her a big round of applause. She's really done a fantastic job. One of those great people to get to know. And for me, it's always a pleasure to go anywhere as a politician where I don't have to wear my ties. So I'm actually enjoying the fact that there's no tie on today. Unfortunately, I'm having a bad day. My Toronto Blue Jays apparently lost to the Texas Rangers this afternoon, so that might be a good thing for anybody here from Texas, but if you're from Canada, it's not the best news. We'll win tomorrow, though. Delighted to be here today. This is an area of absolute priority for us in Ontario. I'm the Minister of Economic Development, Employment, and Infrastructure. I look at this as an opportunity to really maximize growth in our economy. I think it's great that a lot of the social enterprise that we have going on in Ontario now is contributing to building stronger communities. But as Economic Development Minister, I'm looking at the number of jobs that are being created in this sector, and it's huge. We've got 10,000 social entrepreneurs now operating in Ontario. That's about 160,000 jobs that have been created just through this sector alone. It's fantastic for our economy. It's a great place for us to be. And when I come to the Silicon Valley, Ontario is second in North America for information communication technology firms. But when we come to the Silicon Valley, I mean, the Silicon Valley, as we all know, is first in almost all of those categories. But it's nice to come somewhere where I can actually say that Ontario has a bit of a role of leadership in this space. So it's something we're very, very proud of. My role today is to introduce the panelists, and I believe they're ready to come up here now. In no particular order, we have Rory Aiken, Managing Director of Circle Up, Michael Grossman, Director. You can clap for him as we go. Come on now. It's It's been a long day, I know. Michael Grossman, Director of Liquid Assets, New Island Capital, and Nick Flores, Director, Impact Investing, CarProc Group. I think we're in for a bit of a treat here. We're in for a discussion about one of those sort of, an inside discussion about how these deals get done, where we bridge opportunities for social entrepreneurs with investor priorities and opportunities. So I'm really looking for, I've never been in on one of these deals as a politician. I probably never will be, but I'm looking forward to seeing on how all of this has taken place. And we've got some fantastic experts here up on the panel that I think are going to do a fantastic job. So take it away, folks. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining. And today we're going to have a really good discussion around a key challenge that is faced by the impact investing community. So I'm Katie Fitzgerald from Circle Up. And I'll give a little bit of background on that. But first, to really touch on what we're talking about here today. So it's not a surprise that a lot of that funds attract more capital than direct investments. But impact funds have been slower to develop. So we're going to touch on a few questions or try to shed light on a few questions related to that. The first being, how do you really evaluate an investment into an impact fund? And the second being, how can GPs and LPs better navigate that conversation? To do this, we'll use the Circle Up Grow Fund as a case study. And we'll hear from a couple investors that considered an investment into the Circle Up Growth Fund. So Michael Grossman from New Island Capital and Nick Flores from the CapRock Group. And you'll also hear from Rory Eakin on the evolution of the Circle Up Growth Fund, which didn't start out as an impact fund, but evolved to include an impact angle. So shortly you'll hear from both Michael and Nick on how they came to their decision and how they thought about the Circle Up Growth Fund, and then we'll go to Rory. Before we dive in there, a brief background on Circle Up just to provide some context. We are an online investment platform and very much a curated platform, so we accept a very small percentage of the companies that we see. We have to date helped 115 entrepreneurs raise over $130 million in aggregate on the platform, and we currently have over 200 entrepreneurs that are actively raising at the moment and representing in aggregate at $250 million in curated investment opportunities for investors that is open on the platform at this time. We wanted to help even more entrepreneurs, so in late 2014, we decided to raise a fund, so the Circle Up Grow Fund, which is the subject of the conversation today. The two investors that we have on this panel don't need a big introduction. They're well-known, well-respected, so that we can get in, and we have only 20 minutes to cover a lot of ground, so maybe Michael and Nick, if as a part of your first answer, you could give a brief 30-second background on yourselves, but otherwise we'll jump right in. So Michael, okay. Starting with you, can you just describe your objectives as an impact investor?
Sure, thanks. New Island Capital is a institutional scale investment advisor that is captive to one family office. We invest on behalf of one family. We invest entirely for social and environmental impact, and also we invest for profit. Our family whose money we invest lives off the return that we generate. So we're not a philanthropy. We do this in order to make money, and we feel that we should generate an appropriate risk-adjusted return as well as help create impact. You know, if you think about the companies on the Circle Up platform and people who invest in them, they're happy to pay a fair price to that lady who's growing, you know, organically produced, cooperatively tended quinoa in Bolivia. But they never like paying their financiers a fair price. And we feel that we should be paid, just like any other ethical supplier, a fair return. So that's our objective.
Okay. And so New Island Capital ultimately decided to make an investment into the Circle Up Growth
We did.
Fund. Can you talk about how that fit with your objectives?
So it fits really well. So, I mean, we are an institutional scale source of capital. So for us, we try to do large transactions. And for us, a large transaction is somewhere ideally between $5 and $25 million. Obviously, our investment in Circle Up Fund is smaller than that. But we love a firm like your fund because it has the ability to invest in the kind of businesses we would like to, but we can't because of transaction costs being too high for us to do small investments. So if you look at the both why we're excited about this investment, both the market opportunity, the kind of companies you curate, the kind you invest in, the ability to operate within different parts of the capital stack, and also, frankly, the team that you brought to the table with a lot of experience looking at the kind of investments that you're proposing.
Great, thank you for that. And Nick, can you equally give a 30-second background on yourself and sure. then also speak to your objectives as an impact investor?
Sure. So my name is Nick Flores. The CapRack Group is a multifamily office. Unlike New Island Capital, we serve roughly 90 families and probably about 10 foundations. Many of the foundations are connected to the families that we work on behalf of. We have probably about $3 billion in AUM, one-third of which has an impact mandate. And to your second question, sort of in terms of our investment objectives, we share New Island's for-profit motivation. And one of the reasons why we chose to take a pass on the Circle Up Growth Fund, a bit of a contrarian view here. I've known Rory for quite some time. We would have loved to have found a way to make it work. But we evaluate all opportunities first and foremost through a financial lens. So we look at things like the return profile, the correlation with other assets in our clients' portfolios, liquidity, yield, all those sorts of various things. So I just want to make that clear that our orientation as a traditional multifamily office with impact investing expertise is that we evaluate everything first through the lens of financial. The next screen that we take is to sort of look at the impact strategy. And here we adhere to the GIN's definition of an impact investment, two core tenets of which are intentionality as well as measurability or a commitment to measure the environmental or social benefit that the investment ultimately seeks to catalyze. And I'll just try to keep my remarks brief on this point because we only have 20 minutes and I know a lot of you want to probably get to the beer hour. That is really where sort of the consideration for the Circle Up Growth Fund stopped for us. Because I think, as Rory will likely admit, at the beginning, they didn't really have that intentionality. I think it started to grow and evolve as a result of the conversation with New Island Capital, but and although there have been societal benefits, I think that result from the capital that you all provide, we felt like it wasn't interwoven into the investment strategy like we like to see from a lot of the funds in which we invest. And so I think because of that, we felt like the impact that you all drive was more incidental than intentional, and that was really the reason why we passed on the opportunity for impact clients.
Thanks. And Michael, do you have any comments on that, on intentionality and measurability and how you saw that?
Yeah, it's interesting. So our view is, I mean, I hate to say it, almost the exact opposite. We start with the impact lens, right? Does this achieve an impact? And, you know, impact is a... As a capital provider, we are we're a utility, right? We other people create impact. We provide an input for them to create that impact, and so it's not for me to judge others' impacts. You know, so if I can get myself comfortable with this is creating a better world, and I believe that natural and organic foods is generally something that creates a better world, then we'll start looking at the finances,
right?
And we will. You know, same thing, we're very rigorous and very disciplined about the financing of it, but we do seek to have, you know, the first step for us will be, does it make the world a better place in line with the values of our shareholders? In terms of measurement, that's not something, you know, again, lucky, we're great, good fortune of working for some one individual so we can tell stories, we don't have to measure. And it makes it a lot easier. I mean, it really, really does.
Sure. Right? I would imagine for you as well as your investees.
It, very much so, because I mean, one of our fundamental beliefs is a concept of convergence. So as financial return increases, impact increases, mm-hmm. and as impact increases, financial return increases. So we'll ask our investees to measure things that they're measuring already, because it's the kind of things that they're measuring to manage a business.
Right.
So yeah, in the kind of like that big Gears book thing, that's not no offense to any Gears person who's
that's not on your desk.
No,
I get it.
Rory, can you talk about the evolution of the Circle Up Growth Fund and how it came to involve an impact angle?
Yes, absolutely. So it's fascinating to hear two so thoughtful investors on the space, and just thanks for having us and to have this dialogue, because it was a really interesting case study for us in many ways. We started out to raise this fund not with an impact lens. In fact, one of our philosophies was to raise, and we think about scale a lot at Circle Up, to raise as much capital for the entrepreneurs on the site as we could. We didn't want to lead with that lens and that term of impact for fear of being able to turn off potential strictly financial motivated investors. We wanted to aggregate as much capital as could move towards those entrepreneurs in the risk-adjusted way for a financial return. But in talking with a number of folks, including CapRock and New Island, we were being asked the question, well, what is the impact of the work? And being asked, could we codify that in some of our agreements? So with New Island, in fact, they were saying, well, here's how we think about impact. Does a majority of the capital go towards things like B Corps or natural organic foods or local sustainable food enterprise systems? And we went back into our data from the last 2 years just on the platform naturally, and we found that that was, in fact, where a majority of the capital was going. So we were able to make commitments to some of our LPs then in the fund without being forced in a difficult trade-off of changing our strategy. So with the Circle Up Growth Fund, Nick's exactly right. We did not have that ex-ante intentionality around it. But Michael's made a good point. When we looked at the data, we felt we could honor what New Island seeks to do with its capital in terms of helping a number of entrepreneurs we wouldn't otherwise do. And so we don't know how it'll come out.
Can I pick up on something that you just said? Help a lot of entrepreneurs that you otherwise would not. So how did New Island's participation change perhaps the investment strategy, if at all?
I mean, by with the fund overall. So it didn't change. That, what's one of the core things towards all of our LPs is it didn't fundamentally alter the investment strategy of the fund, which is to align with the overall platform. So we had a thesis on the fund that a lot of investors on the platform are making their own, doing their own diligence and investing, and we wanted a fund to mirror the platform to the extent it could. But to have a fund overall with participation from investors like New Island was able to amplify the effort overall.
And I'd like to also say there's something, like, we're at a point right now where, and you might not be aware of this, but where there's something that's happening that I think is really exciting, both for us and for you and for the industry at large, which is we are talking independently of the Circle Up relationship. We're talking to one of your portfolio companies at a fairly large debt facility. Right?
Good to know.
Yeah. And so you took a company that couldn't get necessarily capital, and you incubated it, you grew it, you spent some time, and now it's a company that can actually have a conversation with somebody like us about doing a fairly large growth facility for them to grow their business. And that opportunity doesn't exist without Circle Up. Maybe it does, but I mean, likely it doesn't. And so that impact is also really, for us, really exciting, because this transition from early stage to growth, and then from growth to stability. My principal business is lending, and as a lender, finding opportunities where there's somebody who's thoughtful, intelligent capital, who's worked with the companies to get to a stage where they can actually extend their impact by extending their financing is when we like to intervene. So we're really excited about that.
Rory, you mentioned that you saw the impact kind of naturally playing out with the companies that Circle Up works with on the platform. Do you think Circle Up is at any advantage there, and what might create that advantage?
Well, we only do consumer products and retail. So there is one element here that, because the industries we focus on, naturally, there's a momentum in that space for more impact-oriented. Consumers are shifting their buying behavior. So what makes a good investment from a financial perspective is also riding tailwinds of the impact community, including many of the consumers and investors and folks in this room now. So example of some of the portfolio companies that we've developed through this fund now include B Corps, include Smarty Pants Vitamin, which is a gummy vitamin company, which is a one-to-one match on with Vitamin Angels, providing nutrients as part of their mission. throughout the world. That's gone on to raise subsequently from a private equity firm that's strictly looking for to maximize value for their shareholders outside of the impact lens, but it's riding the same consumer tailwinds. So I liked this conversation because I think there's no easy answers, and adding an impact lens makes it so much more difficult in the fund world because you've got all these vectors of financial return and risk and track record, as Nick mentioned, and impact and what that means to everybody. But I think consumer does help in that sense because it's an active area right now. It's a little bit further along than maybe some other industries.
Well, I feel like where you all sit, too, is really fascinating because you mentioned you'd rather not lead with impact. And we've heard from a number of fund managers, two of which are actually already on our platform, that they have not led with impact and, in fact, have sort of suppressed some of their impact intentions and or goals because they feel like that will convey to the market that they may be concessionary return seeking, when in fact they're not. And I think in the coming years, we're going to face a real challenge because I think there could be, perhaps because of Silicon Valley, perhaps because of that perception that somehow impact seeking funds and firms are somehow concessionary, a real blurring of the lines. And so while I hear you loud and clear that you're able to sort of ride the tailwinds of this impact space, I think other managers might actually face a headwind from that and be forced to sort of grapple with the decision, do we want to portray ourselves as impact, or would we rather, again, sort of suppress that message?
Do you advise one way or another with that sleeve, that 30, one-third?
Well, we advise the fund managers that we work with and that we're contemplating an investment to play up the impact, whether it be social or environmental benefit that they have, because that absolutely is a critical component for our impact clients of why we would invest. Okay. But by no means are we sitting there saying, well, fund manager ABC, you should or should not do this.
Right. Michael and Nick, you guys have both shared that you are looking for financial return as well as having an impact, the companies that you invest in having an impact in society. How do you, you know, there are also different definitions of impact as we're hearing, and return expectations could also vary by investor. So how do you balance those two, and does having a broader definition of what impact means help there?
You want to go first?
Sure. How do we balance the two? Again, I would just say that our emphasis is on the financial first and some of the other attributes that I mentioned up front. And in terms of how we balance it, it largely depends on the client. And I think that's where our models are vastly different. We have some clients who are very much impact agnostic. All they want to ensure is that, to your point, a lot like the family with whom you work, they just want to make sure that their money's going towards something good. We have others that are very thematically oriented toward climate change, a number of other issues, and so it really depends on the client, unfortunately. But I will just say our first focus, again, is financial, and so we really try to make sure that when constructing client portfolios, we keep that in mind and that we never sort of lose sight of that objective.
We don't feel that there's a conflict between impact and financial return. In fact, as I indicated, we believe that the two go together, and we seek to invest or lend in those areas where the two are demonstrably go together. So I don't think it's a trade-off at all. You know, sometimes the challenge is identifying where the impact is and keeping our feet on the ground, because it's easy to get excited about things and being honest with ourselves and understanding, you know, we use terminology, green shades, to make these distinctions of what kind of investments are. So light green, medium green, dark green, and everyone wants to do only dark green stuff because we all want to make the world a better place, and that's why we're doing this. But there are, you know, managers or in portfolio companies or teammates that are doing good, solid work, and just have to support them with our capital, and that's what we do.
And we have 2 minutes left here. So any words of wisdom for prospective fund managers looking to raise an impact fund?
Talk to CapRock.
Yeah, I would say think really long and hard about how your impact intentions are interwoven into your investment strategy.
Yes.
Because I agree with you, there does not need to be a trade-off. And we like to see and prefer to invest in funds and or companies where they're interwoven. We agree with you that they are mutually complementary, if that's probably redundant, but and really think not only through how you what those intentions are and how they weave into your investment strategy, but more importantly, how you will demonstrate to us and hopefully other LPs how you're delivering on that intention. So we're big proponents of data to tell that story, but I think it's really important that entrepreneurs and fund managers alike think through sort of how they're going to demonstrate convincingly that they're doing what they set out to do, because we'll certainly look for it.
My take was ask questions and learn. I mean, so much of this was figuring out the dialogue and the right framework for where the investor's trying to optimize for and what they care about. So it really was, in our experience, more of an opening and finding the right fit with different types of investors. But it's a moving and evolving ecosystem overall. The definition of impact and people's concerns are certainly shifting and growing, and measurement and all sorts of different elements. So ask the questions is my takeaway.
And I guess the one bit of advice I'll give is and this is going to sound counterintuitive if you consider what we're trying to do, but be patient, right? I mean, environmental impact is easier to achieve than social impact. Social impact takes time, sometimes generational time. And so deploy capital intelligently, rigorously, and slowly, and do it right so that the second time you do it, you can do it larger than the first time. Everyone's in a hurry to do one great big fund, and I think one of the great things about this growth fund is that it was a reasonable size to start with. It was a bite size that you guys could handle and deploy.
Well, thank you all again for being here, and thank you to our expert panel. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Katie.
That's it.
I know. Hello, late afternoon people. They're going to clear the stage here for a minute, and I'm going to fill her up. I am really thrilled. Hi, I'm Tim Freundlich. I'm on the board and also the president of Impact Assets, which is the hat I'm going to wear to cover my bald head today. I'm going to talk a little bit and tee up John Strewer, who's the new CEO of Calvert Investments. Calvert, as I said, few remarks last night. I mean, this is an institution that has been in the, arguably, the impact investing space truly for 40 years. So I always try to kind of think as we approach, and I've been doing this for about 18 years now, like we have to think in decades. As impatient as we are, as much needs to get done, we also have to be in touch with the shoulders upon which we stand. And I very much think Calvert Investments is such a place. When I was there starting in 97, they were already doing a ton of microfinance, ton of community development, financial institution investing. They were doing venture investing in social ventures all across the United States and the world. And this is 18 years ago, and they've been doing it for 5 or 6 years already. So I can't sing their praises enough. John, I met him at the beginning of this year when he took over the CEO. He had just left AMG Funds, which is a $60 billion asset management firm, and he's taken over the reins and totally impressed me in terms of his leadership and vision and the refresh I think he's going to. They've done a lot over the last 40 years. I think they're going to do a lot over the next four. I'll just say that. And he's going to come up here and talk about that. Really special thanks to him, too, for the work he's done and the collaborative stance with Impact Assets and bringing some of our new investment notes to market in the next months. So please join me in welcoming John Strewer, the CEO of Calvert Investments.
Thanks a lot. All right, thanks a lot. Thank you very much, Tim. I appreciate it. It's great to see everyone. Yeah, and I wrote down two lines from the program introduction so that I could try to deliver the comments that you came for. One is impact through the capital markets, and the other is how to effectively drive change. I'd just like to talk about that a little bit. What change are we trying to drive? And what role do you all play in that? Well, the change we're trying to drive is to get major corporations worldwide to move their behaviors in a way that's consistent with the evolving social norms that we're all helping to influence. This is the group of people, really, that is on the leading edge of that. You're the social entrepreneurs. You are the innovators. you're on the ground, and you're helping to codify the kind of social norms change that we need, the kind of change that will create a more sustainable environmental system for the planet, the kind of change that we need that will solve some of the tremendous social injustices that our global capital markets suffer from. So you're the leading innovators. You're driving the change. Now, how do we at Calvert use the global capital markets to help impact investor behavior and to further drive the change that you're starting on the ground? What does it mean to work in the global capital markets alongside of the world's largest financial institutions where trillions of dollars are moving daily between companies? And what role do we all play in trying to solve climate change and social injustice? We find it at Calvert necessary to compete on their terms in the respect that we need to produce the financial results that are competitive with all major investors. But we also must find the public companies that are behaving differently, that are changing their operations, and that are treating people on the ground with care and justice, and that are moving their operations forward to have a much less impact on the environment and reduce greenhouse gas emissions and help solve the devastating problems associated with climate change. As we hear about impact investing going mainstream, it's good news, but it's also very concerning, because we must also really understand what companies are doing throughout the world. On one hand, it's terrific to have a global information system that can inform us about what's happening in India and Pakistan and throughout the world so we can see global supply chains. But we need to know the reality of what the companies are doing, and we cannot depend on the financial industry to provide us with metrics that tell us about that. We need a social fabric of people like yourselves to help define the standards and tell us what's happening on the ground. We must maintain independence and objectivity as we seek to use the global capital markets to move our common agenda forward. Critically, we need impact investors and networks of impact investors like those of you in this room. For Calvert's part, we're investing in you through our high impact program, and we are asking large global corporations to do more business with small and medium-sized enterprises globally. We're asking major global corporations to think about how they impact local communities, how they treat people from those who need protection as indigenous people to the poorest people in the world, as well as people with unique cultures that don't necessarily agree with the Western ways. So this is a major effort that we're all involved in together. Now let me talk a little bit about what 2015 looks like, because I think when we look back at 2015, we have the potential to see this as a transformative year, not only for your work, but that of the global capital markets. And I'd just like to cite the work that the Pope did in writing the encyclical and getting major publicity for the needs of the poorest people in the world and for the needs to solve the impacts of climate change. I'd also like to share with you the activities of 10 days ago in New York as we worked to pass the Sustainable Development Goals in 2015. It was a tremendous event, very different from what we've ever seen at the United Nations before, where we had the leaders of the largest nations, not just the finance ministers, but the Angela Merkels, the Barack Obamas, and everybody from around the world coming together with public companies. I was in a meeting with those people, with Mark Zuckerberg from Facebook, with Paul Pullman from Unilever. Our special guest was Bono from U2, and he said metrics three times. So really, we have a unique situation in 2015 where we see a confluence of events coming together to focus world leaders, public policy players, private enterprise on driving sustainable development goals worldwide. It's extremely encouraging, but I just want to close and reaffirm how important it is for the people who care, the people who are really trying to drive change, to have independence and objectivity and not let this become completely co-opted by those who are coming into the space most recently. What can you all do? Well, at Calvert, we are very engaged as an activist in trying to move public companies forward. When we see behaviors by corporate management that we think need to be changed, We contact them, we speak with them directly, and when necessary, we file shareholder resolutions and take it to a vote. This is the role of the investor in the capital markets. We vote our proxies, not just for management, we vote our proxies for the people in an effort to solve these major problems. And you are the people, as I said at the beginning, who are helping to redefine the social norms that we're asking the companies to live up to. We need you to join the movement. We need you to engage. We need you to vote your proxies. We need you to contact company management alongside of the players like Calvert. The more voices, the better. And we are getting success. We're at a tipping point, and we need everybody, particularly those of you in this room, to join in. So thanks for being part of a fantastic movement. Appreciate it. Thank you.
On the first day when we were here on Tuesday, before the conference officially opened, we had a session about entrepreneurship and had our gratitude award entrepreneurs, and then we had some folks who have had many years of experience in successful social entrepreneurship on our stage. And in the middle of that, we had a wonderful presentation, talk, inspirational moment with a dear friend of mine, Becca Stevens from Nashville, Tennessee. And we didn't want only the people who were here on the first day to meet Becca. She is the person who started Thistle Farms, and if you've been by our marketplace, you will see the products from Thistle Farms, and you can hear about the stories that come out of the work that she's doing at Magdalen and Thistle Farms. And Becca's going to come to the stage and talk for a few minutes, and then she's from Nashville, and another Nashvillian who I'm particularly happy is with us this year, Chuck Cannon, will be coming to the stage to sing for us a little bit again. And we want to welcome my good friend Becca Stevens to the stage.
Thank you. So not too long ago, I was invited to be a speaker at a human trafficking conference. And I think I was invited for three reasons. And the first one is because, how do you make this go on? There it is. The first one is because I'm the founder and I've been a part of this work at Thistle Farms for years and years. And we've grown into the largest social enterprise for women survivors of trafficking, prostitution, and addiction. It's run by the women. There's probably 70 employees that manufacture products. We have a great line. People love it, and they wanted to hear about it and hear about this good news. The second reason I was invited is because the model began with Housing First for women who are coming off the streets and out of prisons, who are first raped between the ages of 7 and 11 on average, who first hit the streets about 14 to 16 years old. And we have this old school model. I know here it's really popular to have the newest amazing idea. But sometimes old is the new. And this is an old school model that says love heals. We invite women to come in for 2 years free with no authority living in the house. And it's been a great model over the years. And women have come in, about 80% of the women who come in stay clean and sober 2.5 years later. Thank you for clapping. That is so nice. And so we've started sister communities around the country where we can partner and become a national network for women who are trying to find safe places. We always have at least 100 women on our waiting list. I've had two calls today since I've been here from women in other states who need help, need sanctuary, are running away, and need a place to go. And the third reason that I think I was invited was because we are looking at a global issue and we've had a global response. The universal issues of sexual violence against women are borne on women's individual backs. And it takes small communities to do this healing, but we need to have supply chains and distributions that are global to find markets so women can make living wages and make restitution with their family. And that old saying, rape the women and kill the village, is true. And you heal the women and you heal the villages. So I did my talk. I did my talk. Felt really good about it. People were going to buy the products. We were going to be able to stay open yet another week. When a young woman came up to me right after the talk, a young woman like most of the women that I serve, ran away from home, was stuffed into a trunk, taken to Texas where she was kept for about 18 months before she found a way out. She was at this conference after finding a safe house, and she comes up to me after I finish speaking and whispers in my ear, "Tell me again what love is. All this stuff you're saying, what does it mean?" And I've been thinking about her words the last couple days while I've been here, and thinking about all this language and all this amazing talk. Y'all are brilliant and doing beautiful things. And I think, what does it mean? What are we doing? What does it mean to take our ideals and our hopes for this world and how we want to be in it and live into it with dignity and compassion and love? And I think I've gotten it down to what it means for me. It means first that I do believe that love is the most powerful force for social change. It impacts. It helps us with supply chains. It helps us grow exponentially. Love can do that. It can transform. It can do all of those change-making things we desire. And I think love is this ideal that we are willing to put into practice in our daily lives. I have learned more about love in the drudgery of this work of social enterprise in the daily task than I ever could by just pontificating about it. And finally, I think what it means for me is that it's who and what I choose to let break my heart. She has inspired me, and you guys have inspired all of us here. Jovita, Lori, who are both still in the residential program, Franny and Abby and Rosalie, who have helped orchestrate our being here and directing it. It's inspired me to say, I am just getting started. This beautiful young woman and the two women that she lives with in her house are coming this weekend to Thistle Farms to start their training as the first regional sales team. We have 1,700 women that are part of Share Trade, 70 women employed in Nashville, and we're going to double it. And we are going to have an impact, and we are going to be re-inspired. We get to go around the country and keep one person at a time reminding people that we can be inspired again by love to do this great work we have all felt called to do and live into. Not too long ago, I went to Florida with one of the residents who shared that story, who spent 26 years on the street. We got to Florida, and she said even though she had seen the inside of prison walls and the underside of bridges and the backside of anger and the short side of justice, she had never seen the ocean, so we went straight there. And I got to be with her when her feet first hit those sugar sands. And when she stepped into the ocean, she just raised her arms and lifted her head and said, "Has this been doing this my whole life?" Now, as long all those 26 years that woman was walking the streets, that tide was going in and out. As long as the moon's been spinning around the earth, that tide has been going in and out. But longer and deeper than that tide is love, and it is more powerful. And when we come together and when we hope, we can do great things. Thank you for welcoming us into this conference. Thank you for having us. Thank you for letting us dream bigger again. We love you.
Hey, y'all, let's keep that little message going. Can y'all help me out here just a little bit? Just do this. Oh, whoa. It all comes down to love. Oh, it all comes down to love. Whoa, whoa, it all comes down to love. Whoa, it all comes down. Talking heads talking to us on the television. Silver screen preachers and politicians. See, they got the answer first. They gotta squeeze us. Send money. There's a tax on Jesus. Fix it with a prayer. Fix it with a dollar. Anybody out there ever wanna holler? Oh, oh, it all comes down to love. Whoa, 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 it all comes down to love. Whoa, 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 it all comes down. The self-help guru, they got a bestseller. Ricky Lake's got a bank teller, 1-900, look into the crystal. The NRA says you're gonna need a pistol. They made a little pill, but it might cause cancer. Just a cheap thrill when you're looking for the answer. Oh, 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 it all comes down to love. Oh, 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 it all comes down to love. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Suits on Wall Street, they make another million. Dealer on the back street talking to your children and you cry for help. Nobody listens. You lie awake at night and wonder what's missing. Who can put an end to all the confusion? Look into your heart for the one solution. It all comes down to love. Oh, it all comes down to love. Oh, 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 it all comes down to love. Oh, 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 it all comes down to love. I heard Becca say, why am I here? And boy, that's a really burning question for me. Why am I here? Why is a guy standing here with a guitar in a room full of people who are trying to make a business? I'm confused just like you are. But here's what I know. Here's what I know. Nobody buys anything unless they're moved emotionally. Keep that in mind. Trying to make money takes most of our lives. It's been known to make husbands strangers to wives, until his kids don't recognize him when he comes through the door. It's enough to make you wish money don't matter no more. She's got a minimum wage job, 30 hours a week. On her man just left her with three hungry mouths she's got to feed. And so she's stealing some milk from the grocery store. It'll make you wish money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm, where everyone's rich oh, and nobody's poor. Yes, sometimes I wish money just don't matter no more. How about you? You can make it the measure of how much you're worth, and you can store all your treasures down here on earth. You can buy a big boat that won't sail heaven's sweet shore, That safe harbor where the money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm. Where everyone's rich, oh, when nobody's poor. In the place where the money don't matter no more. No. And all the Christians, and all the Buddhists, and the Muslims and Jews. And the atheist, the agnostic, the Rastafarian, the Zoroastrian, the Presbyterian, Episcopalians, Pentecostals, and even Sikhs and Hindus, the doctor, the lawyer, the preacher, the whore. We all gonna end up where the money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm. Where everyone's rich, oh, and nobody's poor. When we all get to where the money don't matter no more. Everybody remember the first day? Well, here's a little story about what went wrong. I'm doing this for you, Rosa. You let the fox watch the hen house. Your clucking chicken little story's getting scary. You let the dog watch the kitty cat. You let the kitty cat watch the canary. You let the kids have the keys to the candy store. You let the hippie keep an eye on the bone. You let the fox watch the hen house. There ain't no mystery about what went wrong. You let the banker guard the money, but you did not watch the banker. You let the oil man watch the oil field. He bought a shiny brand new oil tanker. You let the corporation pick the politician. You let the politician watch the corporation. And now you're sending round your internet petition about the broke down situation. You let the fox watch the hen house. Your clucking chicken little story got scary. You let the dog watch the kitty cat. You let the kitty cat watch the canary. You let the kids have the keys to the candy store. You let the hippie keep an eye on the bone. You let the fox watch the hen house. There ain't no mystery about what went wrong. You let the gigolo date your daughter. You let the cougar watch your teenage son. You let the smuggler guard the border. You let Jesse James hold the gun. You got the tax man's hand in your pockets too deep. You let the lawyers tell you right from wrong. Now that the terrorist guy's a rocket, I guess everyone can sing along. You let the fox watch the hen house. Your clucking chicken little story got scary. You let the dog watch the kitty cat. You let the kitty cat watch the canary. You let the kids have the keys to the candy store. You let the hippie keep an eye on the bone. You let the fox watch the hen house. There ain't no mystery about what went wrong. You let the fox watch the hen house. And now all your eggs are gone. Thank you all so much. Have a good time tonight.
All right. So you heard this morning that we're talking about impact that comes from other places that you might not have expected it. And what I think one thing we really underestimate in this area where we're talking about capital markets, we're talking about impact through capital markets, is that there's a lot of people making impact through those capital markets in a different way, through activism, through campaigning. And we have someone here with us tonight who brings down the house every year at Personal Democracy Forum, who is a celebrity in this world of activism and organizing. And I just think I'm so impressed with her and really wanted the SOCAP audience to hear these other ways that people are having impact, tremendous impact, and making huge social and environmental change. So please welcome Christy George from New Media Ventures and Taryn Steinbrechner-Kaufman from Some of Us.
I was just saying to Lindsay, it was quite sadistic to put us after guy with guitar. Like, we're not going to be able to sing for you, but knowing that we are the last thing between you and a drink, we will try to make it as interesting as possible.
And I'm short.
Yeah, short and interesting. I'm Christy George. I'm the director of New Media Ventures. We are a seed fund and network of angel investors focused on media and technology startups that create progressive change. And I've been coming to SOCAP for many years and speaking at SOCAP. And one of the things that I'm so excited about today is the integration of politics and activism into the conversation around impact investing. So we were really proud a couple of years ago to have Taryn come into our orbit and to be able to support her work at Some of Us. And I think you are in for a treat in hearing how she's grown that organization from just her, to quite a global behemoth. So, Taryn, why don't we just start? Tell us, why did you start Some of Us? What is it? Why should people in this room care?
Yeah. So Some of Us is over 5 million consumers, investors, and workers around the world working together to push companies to be more responsible and socially, environmentally, politically, getting money out of politics, and so on. And the reason that we're new is because the way we do that is online, and in global internet access, as you know, is like a relatively new phenomenon historically. And so the idea that you could get, you know, 200,000 consumers overnight to express concern about an issue to a company from 180 different countries, that's a new thing, and that's what we do. And the reason that I think this is so important is because major global corporations, as you know, are among the most important political actors in the world. And in fact, like of the top 100 world economies, something like half of them are corporations, not countries. And so when you're thinking, like, who are the people in the world who can change people's lives, it's not just presidents and prime ministers, it's CEOs. And often that change can happen much more quickly than political change. And I came to this work because I came out of the climate movement, and I worked in the lead-up to Copenhagen in 2009, the big climate conference that was a total and complete failure, and took a sort of step back from that and was like, well, I'm an American citizen. The reason that we cannot get this global treaty that everybody knows is the right thing for the world, like, everybody knows the policy solutions. This isn't a mystery. It's purely a power problem. But the reason we can't get that treaty is because of the U.S. I'm an American citizen. So I came back in 2010 and worked to try and get a climate bill passed in the U.S. Also a total and complete failure, as you might remember. And again, the sort of the next step back is, well, why? Why can't we get a global treaty? Because of the U.S. Why can't we get a U.S. treaty? because of the stranglehold that the fossil fuel industry has on Washington. There's no way around it. That's the answer. And so I'm going to do what I can to try and hold corporations accountable, because they really are the power players on most issues.
So is that the problem that you would say some of us is explicitly solving?
Yeah, I mean, well, we haven't solved all the world's problems yet. But the idea is that, you know, in some ways, the economy and the marketplace is actually a more democratic forum than politics. There's literally no politician in the world who cares what every single person on Earth thinks of them. Mm. Even the Secretary General of the UN, like, there's a lot of people on Earth that they really just don't care about. But Pepsi, like, Pepsi literally cares what every single person in the world thinks of them, and with not that much difference in how much they care. You know, an American consumer might only be worth 10 times as much to them as, like, the poorest person in the world, frankly. And so that the ability to mobilize people around the world to hold corporations accountable seemed really potentially quite powerful, and we've seen a huge amount of success in this strategy.
Can you give us a couple of examples of the consumer advocacy campaigns you've run? Because I think what is, at least as grant makers, what has been so exciting for us is how you are winning, essentially, campaigns.
Yeah, it's a lot more fun than politics a lot of the time. one example that's really relevant right now in California that I'm excited about is, I mean, we have a drought, as I'm sure you all know, and it's not just here, it's up and down the whole West Coast. And Nestle is bottling groundwater in California and selling it for a profit right now. And they want to start doing that in Oregon. They have also been doing it in British Columbia. In fact, in British Columbia, the water rate was, I am not making this up, was $2.25 per, let me make sure I'm getting this right, per million liters of groundwater is what they were paying the British Columbian government. And so we, you know, stopping Nestle from doing this would be awesome in and of itself, but it's also an entree into a larger conversation, because Nestle is a very relatable brand for consumers. And so we're running campaigns up and down the West Coast. In California, we held a rally outside of a Nestle bottling plant that got national press coverage a few months ago. In Oregon, we're fighting the new state law that would allow Nestle to do the same thing that they're doing in California. And in British Columbia, we actually had a big win. We had a petition that went totally viral calling on the state government to change the way that they treat water rates, and had 225,000 people signed it, and we took it, delivered it, huge delivery, lots of press, and the British Columbian government agreed and is currently changing in the process. It'll, you know, we don't know what the outcome is going to be yet, but they entered a process they were not in because of our campaign, and so that was really exciting. And as I said, it's allowed us to start a bigger conversation with 5 million consumers around the world about water privatization issues.
One thing that I've heard people say about some of us that is interesting from an activism perspective is that people think of traditional activism as wholly oppositional. Mm. And one thing that is also interesting about what you do is the way you think about having a positive influence on companies as well. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, companies are not monolithic, right? And there are lots of people inside every company who want to be doing good or want at least to be doing better. But they often don't have the power to make that happen. And so what we actually see ourselves doing a lot of the time is providing those internal voices with, like, more sort of external stuff they can point to, and giving them, like, a leg to stand on. Well, if you've got 200,000 consumers who've expressed anger about this thing, then you can call a meeting about it, and maybe some people will come, whereas before you couldn't. Or if you force the social media people and the comms people and to spend 2 days working on this issue, it's going to get to a much higher level in the organization than it might otherwise. So it's not like, you know, we don't... Most people in the world work for big corporations, right? It's not like we think that all those people are evil or something. But the way that the incentive structures are set up, it's not, you know, mm-hmm. it's not easy to to do good always. So,
you started doing consumer advocacy campaigns, but you have also done a lot of work in the shareholder activism world. I suspect that there are people in this audience who have been quite active in that world. Can you tell us how that manifests in the context of some of us?
Yeah. So I really think consumer organizing and shareholder advocacy go hand in hand. And that's one thing, actually, that if you're going to take something away from this, that's a big one for those of you who work as, you know, in shareholder advocacy or in related fields. Like, I think there's sort of a division. Like, we don't, people in those worlds don't know each other. The people in the consumer organizing world and the shareholder world don't know each other very well. But if you're a shareholder, you're trying to get a company to do something, you have to demonstrate a financial risk. And consumers are the ones who are the financial risk a lot of the time. And so, you know, we look for issues where shareholders are doing work, and we look to channel and express consumers' frustration around that in a demonstrable way. So you can say there's 200,000 people who are worried about this thing. We also actually act as shareholders sometimes. So we file shareholder resolutions. We filed a resolution on behalf of some of our members who own shares in Amazon earlier this year and got Amazon. Amazon is notoriously unresponsive to consumer campaigns, but this was around the working conditions in Amazon warehouses, and filed a resolution asking for disclosure around those conditions and got it on the ballot, and Amazon was much, much, much more responsive to that than they had been to other groups' consumer campaigns. And another great example was Kinder Morgan is a Canadian extractives company that's trying to build a pipeline, as many Canadian extractives companies are, and it's going through the land of the Tsleil-Waututh First Nation in Alberta. And so we worked with that First Nation, and we crowdfunded a tour from our members donated to, and we accompanied the leaders of the First Nation group to Wall Street and got them meetings with JP Morgan, with Goldman Sachs, and with eight different institutional investors that represented 10.5% of Kinder Morgan's shares. And those investors had only been told so far that everything was on track, and that, you know, that it was going to be approved, and don't worry, and everything's fine. And they didn't know that the First Nations groups were fighting the pipeline, actually, until we met with them. And since then, it's actually been a whole reversal. Again, it's going to be years before we actually know the outcome, but there's just a five-month delay announced. An Alberta oil newspaper, not a progressive lefty rag at all, said that the whole thing had been a public relations nightmare for Kinder Morgan. So those are the kinds of things, and you know, we would love to work with more shareholder advocacy groups. So,
I'm sort of interested in how you characterized one company as notoriously unresponsive, and then there's sort of ways you can move them up the ladder toward responsiveness. At some level, it seems like there's partly a question of people just didn't know. In this example, it was like they didn't know these people existed. Is that typically what is the difference, or are there other differences that move people
at the end of the day? It really depends. I mean, Walmart is a totally different kettle of fish from, you know, a small company that has never had a PR crisis before. I mean, you guys are all involved. You're on boards of companies, like, you know, different PR experiences, different comms experiences. So it's often, you know, as consumers, we're often like, this is a really important issue, and we get nothing, right? And then this is a really important issue. No, let's yell it louder. Let's do it in this other way. And then you get something that bites, and suddenly you get, you know, somebody once told me, like, if you can just make it something that the CEO has to think about, like, once a week, then, and it, you might, you know, like, CEOs don't want to have to think about your campaign once a week, so...
I think that seems like a pretty good shorthand.
Yeah.
I want to pivot a little bit to Some of Us's model. So Some of Us is a nonprofit organization. At New Media Ventures, we make for-profit investments, debt equity investments, as well as grants. And, you know, people tend to think of ROI in terms of investment and then think of grant making as simply giving money away. And so I'm interested in how you think of both Some of Us's revenue model, which I think would be helpful for people to hear, and how you think of sort of return on investment in the context of a nonprofit.
Yeah. My big top line here would be that it may be counterintuitive, but actually in some cases giving to nonprofits is a better investment than investing in a for-profit company. And by that, I mean if your bottom line is impact and change, which I assume many, that's why many of you are here, there are nonprofits that are actually revenue generating and that require investment in order to generate that revenue, and we're one of them. So we've taken less than $3 million in major donor and foundation funding since we launched, and we're currently raising online $1 million a quarter in small dollar donations. So if you think about that, our early investors, of which New Media Ventures is one, and their investment group, the investors that work through them, like arguably those investors have already had a 10 to 20 times payoff in terms of revenue generated for progressive change. And that's just to date, right? That's going to continue to pay off for as long as we're raising money from small dollar donors. So that's, think about it that way, right? Like you could invest in something and get the money back and then try to give it away for good, but you could also invest in the good thing that's revenue generating to begin with.
How do you know, there's a lot of hand-wringing within this community, since you mentioned impact as presumably the bottom line of every single person in this room, about how exactly to measure that impact, especially in the context of a campaigning organization. You've got the campaign wins, but the kind of change you're seeking is quite long-term. How do you think about measuring impact, or how, and, you know, how might that be instructive for all of us?
Yeah, it's really hard, right? Has anybody got a perfect solution? Because I'd love to hear it. I listened to the panel earlier today talking about this, and I think in many ways the impact investing community is ahead of the campaigning community in measuring impact, but I think we also have lessons to share. And one of the lessons for me is to, like, if you think about your theory of change, right, the thing that you do that makes this other thing happen, that makes this other thing happen, that makes this other thing happen, that means that, like, more poor people have food, right, or whatever it is, whatever your theory of change is, it's often really hard to test that the thing you're doing, which is giving money to some company, is going to result in more people having more food. But you can test links along the way of the chain. You may not be able to test all of them. But so, like, the one thing I would say is, like, keep your eyes open for the links that you can test. So an example of this in campaigning is we pour untold resources into getting people to make phone calls to Congress, right? As a movement. And actually, you know, there's a lot of reasons to think that that works, that has effect, but nobody's ever run a controlled trial to see whether it actually does, and it wouldn't be that hard. You could use a state legislature as a testing bed, and you could generate, pick half of the state legislators randomly on some issue that they don't get lobbied on a lot, and generate phone calls to that half and not to the other half, and see if it affects how they vote. And that's something, that kind of thinking about, like, where are the links in the chain that you could test, and making sure you actually test them. And I think the other thing I would say, which I don't think the campaigning world does a great job of, but I'm trying to change that, is that you should be investing actual resources in measuring your impact. Like, if you invest 10% of all your resources in measuring your impact, and that makes you 20% more effective, then you've won, right? You've won that game, and it's not that hard to get 20% more effective if you, like, really work at it. So I think that's, you know, that's a way to think about it.
Will you tell us, as we're sort of wrapping up, what you're most excited about now in terms of some of us's future, and what we should expect from you in the
next
year?
Yeah, well, so actually, you know, this is a little wonky, but the thing that I'm most excited about right now is technology. Our sector has not really adapted the digital, you know, move on, like, you get a lot of emails, some of them are donation asks. That's still the model that we all use in digital campaigning, progressive campaigning, and the world has changed a lot since that model was invented. Like, people are now reading all their email on their phone. Frankly, they don't really like email very much, whereas it used to be really personal. And we're building a world-class technology team in-house to try and figure out how you use WhatsApp and how you use apps on your phone to try and mobilize more people and just get millions and millions more people engaged.
Thank you for that. As we wrap up, I was sort of thinking about my takeaways from your points, and I think I'm thinking a lot about, one, keeping all of our eyes open for links that might reveal impact along the sort of chain of our work. Two, also to consider nonprofit impact as potentially more efficient than some of the for-profit investments we might make. And then last, to create a campaign that keeps the CEO thinking once a week, and it seems like we'll be able to solve everything. Just join me, please, in thanking Taryn Steinbrückner-Kaufman and sharing some of her wisdom
and
today.
Thank you, Christy.
Yeah. Thanks, Rosalie.
Thank you so much for hanging in with us to the end of the day. We have a party planned over in Herbst, and we'll be with you there for about an hour and a half before you head out to dinner. So join us over there for some drinks and appetizers. We'll see you there.